You're listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by LineStar, the top-rated DFS tool set and number one companion for DraftKings, FanDuel, and Yahoo Daily Fantasy. Go LineStar Premium now at LineStarApp.com. Now, here are your hosts, fantasy baseball experts Joe Pisapia and Chris Meaney.
Hey, yo, what's up, everybody? It's me, Joey P, Joe Pisapia, and welcome to On Deck right here on the LineStar app. It's the MLB DFS podcast. It's me, it's Chris Meaney, and it's you, and it's Monday, and we're fresh off of a fun weekend of baseball, which we're going to recap some of that. Jose Altuve is en fuego right now, and Clayton Kershaw is on the precipice of a return. I don't know, Chris, we went two whole days without a major injury, so maybe I'm starting to feel a little bit better about the baseball season.
Yeah, no more injuries to some big guys, but you're right, Jose Altuve. It was this time last week I had some questions over at The Athletic about Jose Altuve and what should I do with him. He's not the same guy anymore. And it's like, listen, just be patient. Maybe you're not going to get so much power or stolen bases from him this year. But when he's on, he's still one of the best hitters in the game. And he was on full display last week. He had a total of six home runs. He had five straight games of the home run. And one in there, he had two knocks. So, yeah, he's back to being MVP-like form.
Yeah. I mean, the fact that he was going as late as the turn or even second round in some drafts, it was absurd. I mean, the guy was a top five player for two straight years, had almost identical stellar seasons at a weak position, and everybody wanted to write him off. What the hell is going on here? Oh, my God, the recency bias. Oh, so bad. All right, speaking of recency, though, let's go and let's recap the weekend. The Yankees, oh my goodness, the Yankees lost another home series, Chris. And, you know, we were on the Yankees because of the matchup again.
Yeah.
And I think I've learned my lesson now. They screwed us against the Orioles. They screwed us against the Tigers. And now they're screwing us again against the White Sox. I get it. No more Yankees. Yankee pitchers basically are dead to me for the foreseeable future, because if you can't go out and beat these lower teams at home, I got no time for you, man. I think I've been scared straight, Chris.
Yeah, I don't blame you. I mean, they got the W on Saturday, but they still only scored four runs, and they got a couple of them late, right? I mean, they were shut out for the first six innings of that ball game. And then yesterday, we mentioned Carlos Rodon on Saturday for Sunday's, you know, slate. We were interested in him, and you know, his start could have been a lot better, but he ended up getting the W, and he shut out the Yankees offense, which is, you know, doesn't look like anything what we thought they would be. I know some guys are close, like Stanton and Hicks are close to returning, but as of right now, if you like to, you know, bet underdogs, like find some value, I mean, we keep tossing out the possibility of picking on the Yankees at home. They've been huge favorites every time they play at home, and they're just very mediocre right now.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you what. You know, what we were right about this weekend, though, too, going across town for the Mets was, oh, that Jason Vargas game, him and Newcomb. Remember how many runs we liked on the weekend edition of that?
Oh, yeah, we got 18 of them, I believe.
Oh, he didn't even make it out of the first inning. Oh, it's glorious. The walks are all over the place. Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's rough.
It was everything we wanted it to be and more. So if you had shares of the offenses in those games, you did all right. And there were some cheap pieces, too, because there were a lot of guys kind of subbing in that day. So that was a good one. That definitely went our way for sure. The Indians, nothing's going their way right now. I know Carlos Gonzalez got called up, but Corey Kluber stinks. Carlos Carrasco stinks. Trevor Bauer's walking everybody. Mike Clevenger's on the IL. Not good right now for the Cleveland Indians. I know they're very excited in Cleveland for football season, as they should be. Maybe training camp's looking a little early right now, a little looking ahead.
Oh, man, it's so rough there. It really is, and you're just waiting for things to turn around. And I don't know, you know, it may take just Lindor, and who knows? We haven't heard anything about him.
Well, and let's hit that, because we still haven't heard when he's coming there. And you know, part of the reason why we recap stuff is because we always talk about trends here on the show and how those trends are affecting daily. Because right now you're going to see some suppression here coming very soon, I think, from the Indians overall, and that suppression certainly extends to Jose Ramirez, who I think if you are a big baseball nerd, you know, last year, even though the stats overall look very good, towards the end of the year, there were some things you did not like, some trends going in the wrong direction in terms of some of the deeper stats, and that's carried over to this year. And I think no Encarnacion, no Lindor has really hurt him. I guess the question is, has he gotten to a point for you, Chris, where you start to buy in, because he is a better player than this? But my goodness, I mean, it's rough right now. The price is getting lower and lower, but what are you going to do?
Yeah, I mean, I think you take the discount, you know, if you're playing daily, I think you take those shots. And you know, I tweeted out yesterday, maybe he'd break out of his slump against Jacob Junis. It didn't work out. He's hitting 140 on the season. He had a very slow start to the year, or a very slow second half last season. I look at him again today when we get into the matchups as a guy who's a 288 hitter against career left-handed, or for his career against left-handed pitching. And as much as I said, like, you know, from Josh Donaldson, we mentioned Josh Donaldson, eventually he's going to break out. He broke out in that game against Vargas. He scored three runs. He had a home run. Like, eventually these guys are going to turn it around. And from a season long standpoint, I would try to get him. I mean, if you're a Jose Ramirez owner, there's no point in you flipping him right now. You're not going to get proper value for him, but I think there's definitely a window of opportunity to try to acquire him. He may not turn out to be MVP like, but he's a better hitter than this. And I got a lot of feedback about Chris Davis, $500, ha, ha, ha. I joined a contest over the weekend. I think it was a 50-50 on yesterday, and there was over 5,000 people in it. He was 75% owned.
Well, and, you know, we had talked about discount. We had talked about it on the weekend, and we really discussed about going after that and doing it. And we basically said it's a no-brainer. If you're going to play multi-entry, you might as well have one out there just to see if he gets a couple hits. It's a gross return on investment. You have nothing to lose if he doesn't, because basically it's like a pass, you know, right, for the $500, $600, whatever it was. It was ludicrous not to. So I'm not shocked at all that everybody went that route. And of course he delivered, which made it really difficult to separate. Like, in a way, I guess you kind of wanted him and not really be that good.
Yeah.
We dragged all those percentage guys with him.
Right.
Kind of like, well, you got a hit or whatever. It's like, okay, it's fine. Then the rest of the lineups. But all of a sudden, it's like, okay, now all the Chris Davis lineups are in there. Those are the only ones that are competing in the tournaments today.
Yeah, it just allows you to do so much. Because when I was putting together my lineup, I wanted to get some Phillies in there. And it's like, oh, it's just so tough. And then Carlos Rodon's my pitcher. And I really wanted Barrios. And then just, oh, yeah, Chris Davis is $500. I'm going to save myself so much money and plug him in, upgrade him Barrios. And he was fantastic. So it's something to think about. I know the Orioles are not playing today. Or they are at 11 o'clock, rather, so you're not going to be able to get him in. But just keep an eye on him going forward. It's like a free square. If he can get you a knock, a single or two, and you'll be on your way.
Yeah, Gerrit Cole looked like Gerrit Cole again, so that's a good thing. We like that. That's certainly something to keep our eye on. And Jacob deGrom, two starts in a row here of the non-quality variety. So he's starting to have a rough patch for the first time in, I'm going to say, years. Oh, man, because I can actually say that. He's actually had a rough patch in years. Atlanta's a good lineup, so I don't want to take anything. Maybe he was just excited for Game of Thrones and he wanted to get home sooner. I don't know.
It's
maybe
possible. That's what
it was. He's like, I got it on the DVR. I got to get on the flight. I got to get back. Where's my HBO go? Somebody get me. All right, so let's get after it, and let's take a look at today's slate here. And, of course, we've got that 11 o'clock Boston game this morning, right, which is always fun. You know, the Patriots Day game or whatever it is. Yeah. So there you go. That's a game that always screws up everything. Yeah. Like, we're like, why do they keep doing this? But whatever. Let's get to the big ones here, and let's start with Noah Syndergaard versus Aaron Nola. This one's in Philadelphia. Great marquee pitching matchup. But let's be honest, Aaron Nola has not been good this year. This is a tough ballpark, but I do believe that Noah Syndergaard 10K is not a bad investment on the DK side. I really don't. I think there's a lot of big pitchers on the slate, a lot of big names. But in terms of guys right now, the trust factor, I trust Noah Syndergaard more than I trust Aaron Nola for $400 more. Do you want to sell anybody, Chris, on the opposite end of the opportunity of Nola finally getting right and there being less ownership on him tonight?
Yeah, I could get, for sure. I mean, they're both stud pitchers. We've talked about this before. It's really hard to pick one or the other when they're going up against each other, you know, just to split hairs and get that W. But, you know, if I'm going to lean one side, I'll probably lean with you in Syndergaard because of what I've seen from Nola. I mean, I need to see a strong outing from him before I can really just go all in on him. Tournament side, sure, you want to have a couple shares of Nola. I have no problem with that. There's some guys in the Mets lineup who can strike out as well. Same with the Phillies. But for Nola, I mean, 8 walks. He's allowed 5 home runs. He only has 13 strikeouts to his 15 innings. He's given up 14 hits over that span, 11 runs. So it has not been good for Aaron Nola. And what I've noticed, too, with the Mets, and we keep talking about them, but I don't think we've really dug deep into their lineup. They seem to be going under-owned in every single tournament, Joe. Like, every week, I think they're an underrated stack, and I know they're against Nola, but even still, they've had some tough pitching matchups this season, and they've had some success. So I know their prices, like Conforto's up at 4.5, Alonso's up at 4.8, but there's some guys in this lineup, like Nimmo off the top, Cano is going to come around.
Well, Cano at just 3.5. Cano is one of these guys too. He's a great hitter, and yeah, he's going to have a little down thing sometimes and stuff, but I never feel like they give him enough credit in daily fantasy. And it just seems like every year, and Ramos back in the lineup too. Yeah. Like you said, you know, Ramos and Cano at 3.5 and 3.6. Those are some pieces right there going against Aaron Nola, where you could even go Cano, Conforto, Ramos in the 3.45 and really get a fair amount if you want it. Or you could do Alonso, Cano, and then skip Conforto if you want to because of the pricing. But right. I think this Mets lineup right now, I don't think the ownership will be high because in people's minds, they see Aaron Nola and they're going to fade away from it. But Aaron Nola hasn't given you any reason to fade away from him yet. So
right. Yeah, I'm not saying it's a strong stack. I'm saying it's an underrated one. And why not just pay to find out to see if Nola really is going through something? Like, it's not going to surprise either of us if he comes out and has a pitch as a gem. But for the fact that he has, again, allowed 5 homers and 8 walks, it's not like him. And the fact that he's at home going up against an underrated offense, there may be an opportunity to continue to ride some of these Mets bats just with the low ownership.
All right, here you go. This is the if you feel lucky moment of the show. Yu Darvish, 7.8K against the lowly Marlins and Trevor Richards. Now, look, there's a ton of strikeouts in this lineup. I know he's dangerous as hell, but it is the Marlins.
Where are you going?
I think I'm going to roll the dice. I can't.
You're gonna go Darvish.
Let me tell you something. It's in the discussion. it's got to be because of the price tonight, too, at 7.8. And there you have to understand that you're absolutely correct if you say, nope, I want no part of it. I'm going to run away because he scares the hell out of me. You'd be wrong. You wouldn't be wrong. I mean, there's no way to say that. However, you know, it's getting better. I feel like the Yu Darvish thing is getting better. I understand he gave up the 4 earned runs. I understand that he gave up the 2 dingers the last time, but he's going a little deeper into the game. He went from the 2 1/3 to the 4 to the 5 1/3. So I think he's building stamina. I think with Darvish, the more he's pitching, the better he's going to get as the year goes. Because of the matchup is the one reason where I'm willing to go. Like I'm willing to roll the dice with it and see what happens. And there was a little extra rest too because of the rain out yesterday. So for me, I'm looking at this as an opportunity. It's definitely one of those, you know, it's a tournament play only, but I think I'll roll the dice. How do you feel about it?
Yeah, I mean, his price has dropped down so much, even over on the FanDuel side, 7-1. He's right in the middle of the pack. I mean, he's cheaper than Trevor Cahill.
Great option. With a great opponent, too.
Exactly. That's what I was going to say. Like, he's cheaper than Trevor Cahill, who has to go into Texas, face the Rangers, who have a 5-team implied total, where for Yu Darvish, going into Miami, a spacious ballpark for him, a good chance at a W if you can just get those 5 wins. And then Miami has a 3.8 team implied total. So I think you're right in saying that Darvish, the more we see from him, maybe he shakes off that rust. You got to remember, only 40 innings from him last year, and they all came in the first half. So it's been a long time since he's been able to put together a few starts in a row. So this is number 4. Let's even go a bit deeper. I have no problem taking a couple shots on him in tournaments, take the discount, just see. Because if he doesn't figure it out and start in Miami against this Marlins team, then there's
ballpark, the big time question marks from him. That's the other thing, too, about Darvish, too. He's never been a cold pitcher, you know, and you know, early games in Chicago, that ain't good, you know. No. That's not a good place. And I can't remember where the other start was he had too.
I think he had in Washington, which was a cold environment there too.
So you know, get him down in Miami, get him out in a bigger ballpark, and especially when we go to this next game with Shoemaker, who's basically the same price on DK. He's 8K, Darvish is 7.8. if you're doing multi-entry tonight, you have 2 lineups that are identical. You got one that's got Shoemaker and one that's got Darvish, because the ownership on Shoemaker is going to be huge tonight, I think, on the salary going against Martin Perez. Now, I know that's a hitter-friendly environment in Texas, but Shoemaker's been on a roll. The price is right. I think a lot of people are going to go there, but I think it would be wise in the multi-entry tonight to have the Darvish version of that same lineup because the cost is basically the same.
Yeah, that's a good call for sure. And if you're not going to play Darvish and you're not buying into it, you know, take a shot on some other guys that are cheap. Ryan Anderson is an underrated bat, I think, at $2,900. We've been talking about Castro as well, $3,300. So if you're not going to go the Darvish route.
Neil Walker, too. I mean, right? Neil Walker's another guy, 3.3. I mean, we've done this once or twice already. Yeah. And you're right. That's a great point, Chris. If you are on the opposite end of the Darvish spectrum, then go get him.
Yeah.
Go after him.
go after him. I mean, I'm not saying to stack Miami, but you could save yourself some cash by spending down at, you know, at second, third, or you know, even Neil Walker in there at first, whatever you want to do. Interesting with Martin Perez, who's making his first start of this season. He's got 8 innings under his belt, and, you know, he's got a 9.72 walks per nine. This is a guy who really just, he doesn't strike out a lot of guys. He walks some guys. He gets in trouble with home runs. Last year, he allowed 16.85. He is fired up for this start today. He said he's a veteran arm. He didn't come in here to just pitch out of the bullpen. Now, Minnesota had, I think they had like a few days off to start the season, so he was just coming out of the pen. He says he is ready to go today. He has no limit at all in his pitches, and he guaranteed a win. He Mark Messier'd. He said he's going to get a win today.
And I want to apologize because in my head, I'm still thinking Martin Perez in Texas. I just can't shake the awfulness. So when I said hitter-friendly environment, I apologize. It's Minnesota, not Texas anymore. Old habits die hard. It's why sometimes I still say San Diego Chargers.
Oh, it's so easy to.
But Martin Perez, I have such a vision of him being awful for Texas for so long.
Yes.
It's a tough thing to shake, but now he can be awful for Minnesota. So I apologize. That being said, Randall Grichuk is the guy that comes to mind. He's having a terrific season. It's a good matchup for him. I mean, Freddie Galvis right now is hitting the ball well. You want to talk about the sneaky stack? You talked about the Mets before. How about them Blue Jays, too, against Martin Perez? Because I think Galvis, Smoke, Teoscar, Randall Grichuk, those four guys are all in play, all 4.3 or less on the DK side. And I think that's there's going to be some runs against Martin Perez historically, a very hittable pitcher and not a guy that can get out of his own jams because he doesn't put guys away. He's never been a strikeout pitcher. He never will be. So to me, there's a real opportunity here with Toronto.
Yeah, I think there is too. And a lot of people just look at the Jays and they see they're striking out the most in baseball. I mean, they can't generate a lot of offense, but this is a really good spot for them. And you mentioned Galvis. I think that's a really good call from you. His price has dropped, has jumped up considerably, but he's on a heck of a run so far this season. He's hitting .351. He's getting on base. He's scoring runs. He's even gotten some home runs. He's got 5 on the year. I mean, I wonder what number he'll get to. Maybe it's just 15, but he's got a
full-time. He's gotten to that before, Chris. You know, exactly. He's not a guy that's bereft of talent. He just he hasn't been somebody that organizations wanted to hand over the job to because there's always been somebody else coming that they had higher hopes for. So he's a decent major league player. He's not outstanding, but he's a decent major league player on a good run. So take advantage of it.
And he's a guy who hits good. He hits lefties good too, Joe. Last year, .291 against left-handed pitching in 2018. So I think it's a good opportunity. Start, you know, set the table with some of these Jays and. No one's thinking about him, I'll tell you that.
I can't believe how burned I was to still think Martin Perez and I can't shake it out of my head. I just can't.
Well, you're not wrong with looking at the Texas forever, his whole career. I mean, last year, 42% hard hit.
I just see that name and I go, let's go get some offense.
It's easy too.
All right, let's go over to where there's going to be a ton of offensive shares tonight. It's going to be probably the chalkiest of the chalk. You got Dakota Hudson, the young kid, 6.2 on DK, going up against Freddie Peralta and the Brewers in Milwaukee. Yelich has been a little quiet, but look, if you're looking for some breakout time, this is probably where he gets back on track. There's going to be a whole lot of ownership in this game, and with good reason. Peralta was not good in his last start. Hudson's probably going to be limited, and you know, he's a 5-inning pitcher at this stage in his career. I want to ask you about Paul Goldschmidt because I know he's been a little quieter. The power's still there, but is this the perfect opportunity here in this ballpark for Paul Goldschmidt to kind of – you know, get back on track a little bit? I feel like it is. At 4.3, that is a huge Paul Goldschmidt discount.
Yeah, absolutely is. And the one thing I noticed about Peralta is, he can strike guys out, but he is also a guy that gives up a lot of bombs. And just a small sample size for him, this is his second year in the majors, a 42% hard hit rate, a 52% fly ball rate. So he gives up a lot of contact, and it's hard, and it's through the air. So this is a good spot for Paul Goldschmidt, who is a fly ball hitter, right? Let's be honest. So, I think it's a great call, and you want to get into the stack. Carpenter is off to a slow start.
I was going to say, and even better is Carpenter at 3.8, too.
Absolutely.
You got those guys back-to-back here. Carpenter leading off and Goldschmidt hitting 3.8 and 4.3, respectively. On the DraftKings side, that is terrific.
DeYoung has only gone, I think, two games this season without a hit. Like, he's been very consistent this year, hitting .306 in a really good spot in the order.
And on the FanDuel side, too, for those two guys, it's 3.4 for Carpenter, 3.8 for Goldschmidt. So, certainly still within the rung, too. Yadier Molina is pretty cheap, too, at 2.7. Just want to point that out. Catcher can always be a pain sometimes if you want to go catcher route. You know, so now you have the catcher slash first base thing on the FanDuel side. You know, you tend to want to go the other way. But as a utility bat tonight at 2.7, I think that's a responsible guy to get in there on the cheap. We always like to do that in the utility spot on FanDuel. We have like the responsible guy. We did it with Dozier last week.
Yes.
We did it with a couple. Who else did we do it? Either somebody else last week too when it hit. So we've had a good run with those kind of 2.5, 2.4 kind of players. This one's a little higher, and I know we don't usually go catcher, but it's in the middle of the order with a lot of potential offense in this game. So the chalky Brewers, are you dancing with them tonight or what?
You know what? I kind of lean more on the St. Louis side of things. I have no problem, obviously, with this Brewers lineup. I think it's great. And Hudson is, you know, he's given up some contact. He's been great in his three outings. His ground ball rate is, this is a perfect spot for him to pitch. I mean, again, a small sample size, but so far this year, 66% ground ball rate. And you just look at some of his minor league numbers, it's much of the same, like 58%, 59. I mean, one was a very small sample size, but he had 90% ground ball rate in just three outings. So he keeps the ball on the ground. He limits the damage. So I'm if I had to pick between the two, I like St. Louis, but I look at the team implied total and I see 5.2 compared to 4.4 in St. Louis. It makes me think, well, Milwaukee's probably going to be able to have some success. But I mean, most of it is just, it's on the ground. Like I said, Hudson limits the damage. So I'll take a shot on some of these maybe lower owned bats, some guys that are struggling like Shaw and Aguilar. I like them in the 4-5 spot. I feel like in tournaments, they're not even thought about. It was like Mike Moustakas, right? Mike Moustakas had that slow start. All of a sudden, he hits bombs.
And we were all over that. And that was another guy, too. That was another utility guy.
It was.
When he was dropping down, we said, hey, look, you got to get some of the shares of him. Now, this next one, you might think I'm crazy, but I'm going to hear me out. Okay. Trevor Cahill at 7.7 is another one of these guys, too. Kind of fits in that mold that we talked about before where we said, all right, who are the guys, you know, that are in that mid to low range and starting pitching tonight that you could do a couple of tournament lineups and make it work? And he's 7.7 on the FanDuel side and 7.1 on the DraftKings side. And he's gone six innings every time. I understand Trout is not in the lineup, but
he should return today.
Is he going to, or is he just back with the team tonight?
I think he's going to play.
All right. Well, you pay attention to that as it goes, because I wouldn't be shocked if he sat one more time. I know he's traveling, so we'll see how that works out. But it's certainly not it's a little bit ballsy. I think there's a lot of ballsy tournament plays tonight in play. And I think Trevor Cahill is one of them because Shelby Miller stinks. and as much as I don't love the Angels offense, I think they can muster enough here potentially. And Trevor Cahill's been decent. And he was decent last year too when people kind of didn't realize it.
Yeah, it's just really been a matter of health, I think, for Trevor Cahill. Like every time I feel like he gets going, something just seems to pop up for him and an injury happens. So I think what we're looking for, Joe, is strikeouts. And, you know, Texas top 10 strikeout rate in baseball. In fact, top 5 looking at it right now. And also struggled lately. So there's some, you know, if you're looking at just swing strike percentage with Trevor Cahill, like he's up near the top for his career double digits. Last year, 11.7. So far this year, 11. So I think it's a good opportunity to rack up a few strikeouts. Some decent underrated call by you.
Yeah, I'm going to stay away from the Texas lineup too, because I think if I believe in Cahill, no matter what,
right,
even if I'm not, even if I'm not starting Cahill, I believe in Cahill enough that I think he's going to give them a little bit of trouble, even in that ballpark. You know, the bottom of that lineup isn't very good. I think I'm just going to stay away from them altogether. Now, something we joked about, our favorite member of the Office Space cast, Heath Fillmyer, is back for more. And, oh, boy, we trolled him last time and we got five runs and three innings out of him, which was great. We thank you, Heath. We appreciate you, and we'd love to have you visit us again today on Monday. Now, keep in mind, you know, there's some wacky weather going on, especially in the East Coast, so just keep that in mind as you're looking through tonight's games. And, you know, we'll hit anything if we get any word about anything during the show. Obviously, we'll get that information to you. But, look, here he is going against Ervin Santana. If ever there was a time to get into some offense with these two teams, it's now. This is it. Here we are. Let's do it. And look, Yoel Moncada has feasted off of bad pitching this year. There's a great opportunity for him to continue to feast off that bad pitching. So I like him for sure in this one. And honestly, the only trouble is Mondesi is too expensive at 5.1. Whit Merrifield at 4.6 is easier to deal with. Mm-hmm. But I wish there was more I could get excited about on the Royals side. But I really can't, because there are not a lot of great bats. So I'm at a crossroads here. How do I approach this? I don't love these bats, but I think there's going to be offense tonight. So what do I do, Chris?
I know that, you know, DraftKings and FanDuel have done a really good job here because you're right. There's going to be some runs scored, currently a 9.5 total. It's tied for the second highest total on the slate. You see Chicago 5.1, Kansas City 4.5. But I know I thought the exact same thing as you.
Polka sucks. Like Aloy is, you know what? Aloy and Tim Anderson are on an upward trend right now.
Yeah, so
maybe you hope that that kind of carries over. I mean,
they're better price. They're better, you know.
Well,
discounts
here you go.
On
you got Yonder and Aloy at 3.9 each, and then Tim Anderson at 4.5.
Yeah,
maybe that's this chunk of the lineup you want tonight. Maybe you want 4.5, 6 there.
Yeah, I mean, it's so tough to spend 4.5 on Anderson when you can just spend 4.3 on Jose Abreu. I know it's just different positions, but. And Anderson, we mentioned him too heading into the weekend. He had a grand slam on Sunday. He continues to hit the ball well. So this is a good spot. You want to continue. I mean, if you play on FanDuel, Jimenez at 3 and Anderson at 3.8. Alonso, who had a successful weekend, he's 2.6. Abreu's 3.1. Like there are some strong, strong discounts over on the FanDuel side if you play over there for the White Sox. And I just look over and I see the Royals, and it's like Alex Gordon is off to a great start, but he's 4-2. Are you kidding me? I never would have imagined that
there's
he would
no be quarter. 4-2. There's no quarter. There's nowhere for you to hide. It's
no,
really, it's crappy. It's really like it's,
yeah. I would rather stack the White Sox and spend up for their bats. I really would against Filmer. That's the way.
Well,
that
– because I mean, once he's out in the third inning again, then you're going to get that bullpen for a long
exactly.
time.
Exactly,
it's going to be beautiful. So
and the White Sox have they have an underrated bullpen. They have
well, they hit home runs too.
Yeah.
You know, there's some power in that lineup. McConaughey, Abreu, even Alonso, Jimenez has power. Anderson's got some power, not consistent, but there's definitely some guys. All right, let's go to Colorado Rockies, Senzatela against Joey Lucchese. I'm staying away from this one from the pitchers, but it was nice to see Arenado get on the board home run-wise. Slow start to the year, but he's got a matchup against a lefty, and you know Arenado just feasts off those guys. On the Padres side, offensively, same kind of thing. It's like you're looking around, you're trying to figure it out. You got the righty-righty matchup. It's a pretty middle of the order, is very right-handed heavy for San Diego. Not loving this one in terms of total. How about you, Chris?
Yeah, I don't see a lot of offense here. Colorado has been really slumping. You mentioned Arenado breaking out of that slump, but, you know, this is a team that you look at them and you think of them. This is a team that destroys lefties. They have their way, but they've really just been, you know, striking out the sixth most time in baseball, the fifth most against lefties. It's just those two guys, and Arenado and Story in that lineup, who really crush lefties. Blackman, of course, can have his way, but they've just had such slow starts that I've been picking against them. But Lucchese's not a huge strikeout guy. He could rack up a few, but I kind of just stay clear of all this. Keep an eye on Will Myers. I know he missed the last couple games with an injury. He could get back in the lineup. What's interesting to me about San Diego's lineup is Manuel Margot is he's been hitting top of the order over the past few days. Like Ian Kinsler has lost that opportunity. He's lost that spot. He's projected to hit 8th now. He's been hitting 7th. So Margot has hit a couple home runs. He's not that type of guy, but just if you're looking at somebody who's going to maybe just get another plate appearance or at bat in what is an underrated lineup, moving forward, somebody to think about because he's priced pretty accordingly.
Yeah, I would agree. Okay, let's go to my favorite guy, cash game. And I know we've saved this matchup too. I mean, it's late, but we've also kind of saved it because this is the big one everybody wants to talk about too. With the return of the glorious Clayton Kershaw, and you're getting a zero discount on him.
Zero. Yeah. How deep is he going to go today?
Like, I don't know, but that's my problem. Look, yeah. Luis Castillo's been great. Luis Castillo is less than Clayton Kershaw on DraftKings, okay? Yeah. Now, that's just begging for it. Just begging for it, and I'm the one who's going to do it. So, Luis Castillo, my favorite cash game pitcher on the night, and it's not something I'm going to apologize for. I'm going to be unabashed. I've been right every time, and I understand LA's had a great start to the year. I get that, but I don't care. I mean, and on the FanDuel side, too, Luis Castillo, 8,800. Clayton Kershaw, 10.8. What? Go home, FanDuel, you're drunk.
I mean, it's basically been a perfect start to the season for him. 25 strikeouts and 19 innings.
What does this guy have to do, Chris?
He's got a 0.66 whip and a 0.92 ERA. Oh. And, you know, this is the matchup. I'm very, very interested to see what kind of performance he's going to have against the Dodgers. You know, it's a good ballpark for him, but the Dodgers don't strike out at all, and they've been just mashing home runs. But, you know, for Castillo, all three of his starts have been in at home. right, in Cincinnati, which is not a great ballpark.
Yeah, but you know what? Historically, he actually has a better home ERA than a road ERA for his career. A lot of people wouldn't think that, but if you go and you peel in the numbers, you'll see it. The career ERA is actually lower at home of all places for him.
Very interesting. And it'll – and
a little nugget for you. There you go. There you go.
And but what I'm saying is, like, he's still had success. Yeah, so, I mean, you back it up there with the numbers, but the fact is he still had success in what has been a tougher ballpark than any other ballpark that, you know, he's going to face or that he's going to be pitching, which starts tonight in LA against the Dodgers. And that, let me tell you something.
I might just go all in here. I might go Castillo, Puig, Suarez, Kemp, and just go at it. Kemp,
you'd be crazy not to go Puig, right?
Kemp going back to LA, Puig going back to LA, getting a shot at Kershaw with their best pitcher on the mound. You give it to me, man. The crowd's going to be live. They're going to be excited for Clayton Kershaw, and I think the Reds are going to rain on their parade. I really do. Because even if Kershaw's good, like you said, what are you expecting out of him? Five innings? He ain't going six plus tonight. That ain't happening. Not the first shot out of the gate. They got way too much invested in him this year to do that.
The only way he would go six is if he just, yeah,
he was just super economical.
Quick outs.
But
yeah.
Joey Votto on his own is going to see 25 pitches.
Exactly. So. And, you know, Puig hit his first home run of the season yesterday. Some of these Reds bats are starting to heat up, right? We said that. It was that series against Miami. Looking here, 14 runs, five runs, another five yesterday against St. Louis. So some of these bats are starting to heat up a little bit. This is going to be a fun ball game to watch. Two nice pitchers going toe-to-toe. And again, some of these Cincinnati bats are just, I think they're great tournament options.
I agree. And because they got power, you know, yeah. Guy like Puig can have a huge night. A guy like Kemp can, you know, at a 3.3 on DK, especially where the offense has been a little tight on DK this season in terms of pricing.
Oh, it has.
That's a loose spot right there that you can go target with Matt Kemp. All right. Last one of the day, Trevor Bauer, 10.4 versus Yusei Kikuchi and the Seattle Mariners, 7.7 on the DraftKings side. And looking at this, you know, Bauer had some walks in his last one. The one thing in this game, look, at Haniger, even with a tough matchup on the weekend, on Sunday, he still came through with a home run against Cole. Haniger is still a terrific player. You know, I love him all the time. I always want the Mitch Haniger. But in this one overall, with Trevor Bauer on the mound, I think there's other options tonight where, as good as Seattle's been, I feel like they're going to start to slow down a little bit. And the one piece of this game I don't think I want to invest in, but I've got my eyes on, Carlos Gonzalez is hitting in the three hole. And right now he's only 3.5. And there might be a short window where he's really inexpensive. And if he has a hot start to the year, Chris, hitting the three hole, it's something I'm going to pay attention to and start to have shares of, but not tonight.
Okay, yeah, that's fair. I was going
to
say.
Not against the lefty Kikuchi, not tonight. But I just want to see it. Or, you know, this is one of those things like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, I want to see how he does out of the gate.
For sure. And yeah, I was actually looking at him last night, and because that's the exact same thought process I have, is some of these guys that, you know, for Cargo, who's just obviously played his first game yesterday, and some other guys that are slumping, especially in this lineup like Jose Ramirez, I want to jump all over it. But yeah, I was looking at Gonzalez over the past couple of years. Doesn't hit lefties all that well. I mean, 2017 was a decent season for him, and he only hit 206 off lefties. And then last year, he only hit 259. So it's not a good spot for him. But yeah, keep in mind going forward, I think Jose Ramirez, I'm with you. I'm going to stay away from this game altogether. I like Trevor Bauer. It's just, he's not getting the run support. He's walking some guys, but he has the potential to win you a tournament every single night that he takes the ball. 100%. I really do feel that
11.2 on FanDuel.
It's just too much. Yeah.
And just to inverse too, Jose Ramirez is 3.1 tonight on FanDuel. Carlos Gonzalez is 2.9. Now I will say this, Jose Ramirez at 3.1. You want to talk about a utility filler?
Yeah.
That works for me.
288 against lefties for his career. 329, Joe, in 28.
Yeah, and that's the whole point. Like, you know, at a certain point, it gets so low that I think I want to dance a little bit there, and I think I will. And the reason is because now when you get a legitimate guy like Carlos Gonzalez in the middle of that order, say what you will about him, he's a professional hitter. He always has been. Yeah, the numbers outside of Coors haven't been as good. Of course not. No one's are. But at the same time, I think there's opportunity there with Carlos Gonzalez, at least his presence in the order, that it lengthens the order a little bit and it makes somebody really have to work a little harder. And then eventually when Lindor comes back and you start adding these guys in, it's going to be different. But right now, I'm not saying Carlos Gonzalez is the difference maker, but maybe tonight, because of the suppressed pricing, Jose Ramirez on the FanDuel side, at least, is worth entertaining. So to recap everything, Luis Castillo and the Reds. Yeah. Clayton Kershaw. Boo. We're not thinking he's going to go very long in this game. We shall see what happens with that. We're fading Seattle, who's been good this year. We are going for the White Sox in that Royals contest there, even though Irvin Santana sucks too. we're going to go ahead with our with our guys in the middle of the White Sox order. There's going to be a ton of offense in Milwaukee. We're going to stay away from that just because it's a little chalky. The ownership's going to be super high. Although Carpenter and Goldschmidt, we might have to break down and go on that end of it as well. Trevor Cahill, sneaky guy, along with Shoemaker and Yu Darvish, if you have the cojones to do it. And we are going to troll Aaron Nola until he proves differently, because so far, I got to say, we like Syndergaard. Before we go, Chris, betting-wise, what do you see on the board tonight that you want to put some cash on?
I'm going to take the Cardinals as a road dog. I'm feeling their offense against Freddy Peralta. I think there's going to be some bombs there. If you're not comfortable with that, I think the over certainly could hit at 9.5. I'm going to take the Cubs on the road. I'm going to side with Yu Darvish. I'm going to have them in a couple tournaments. I'm going to trust that the Cubs offense can do enough and give them some run support. So I like that as well. I'm going to take the over in the Texas and the Angels game at 10.5. And why not just jump on? I'm going to jump on board with you with Castillo and the Reds. I'm going to take them as road dogs as well, plus 140 right now on the road in LA. It's going to be a tough matchup, and give me the White Sox at home.
Hey, how about the road dog of the Blue Jays against the Twins and Martin Perez, huh?
Yes, I just I think Shoemaker could have a really good showing. Right. I just
Martin Perez.
You know what I think is going to happen there?
Martin Perez. Yeah. What?
I think Minnesota's just going to score a couple runs late against that Blue Jays bullpen.
Yeah, well, you're probably
That'll
you're
be good.
Right. That's probably it. All right, so that'll do it for us. Make sure you're subscribing to the show On Deck right here on the LineStar app. It's on iTunes. It's on Stitcher. It's on everywhere you could get podcasts. So if you enjoy the show, please like it, share it, and give us a 5-star review, because we appreciate it. And when you subscribe, you know exactly when the show comes out. We'll announce the winner of the giveaway that happened on Friday. And if you want more stuff given away, tweet us. And we are continuously taking suggestions from you folks. We've been doing the recaps. Do you have somebody who's a lock to go yard tonight?
Oh, that's a good one. That's the one. Goldschmidt. That's it. We talked about him so much. Why not Paul Goldschmidt?
He's I like it. I'm going to go Matt Kemp, sticking it to his old teammate. There
That'd
you go.
Awesome.
Yeah. All right. So that'll do it for me and Chris. You can follow us on Twitter at LineStar App, at Joe Pisapia 17, and at Chris Meaney. There's only one thing left to do, and that's step out of the On Deck circle and step into the box and go yard. We'll see you next time, kids.
You've been listening to the DFS On Deck podcast, brought to you by LineStar. Hit subscribe, tell a friend, and stay tuned for the next episode from fantasy baseball experts Joe Pisapia and Chris Meaney.